Members of the panel on welfare services, good morning. We have a quorum. It's the appointed time. First item on the agenda, information paper issued since the last meeting. There is none. We have not received any. Second item, items for discussion at the next meeting. The next regular meeting will take place on the 12th of June at 10:45. The administration proposes that these two items are to be discussed in the next meeting. First, provision of elderly service facilities in private development projects. Two, support for carers. Mr. Tek Chi Yun, 1 minute. I do think that it is good that we can discuss these two items, but can we get some updates? Because during the epidemic, the administration said that there would be a review on elderly services. Are there any ways for us to follow up on this matter? So it means that these two items cannot address the concerns of Mr. Tek Chi Yun. So regarding elderly services, residential care homes, I think it is more difficult for residential care homes because during the fifth wave of the epidemic, they encountered a lot of difficulties. There was insufficient support. And recent days, these operators indicated that they are quite concerned about the situation. The administration said that there would be a mechanism to review the service quality of elderly services. But we are completely in the dark regarding progress. Would there be a report? Is it in progress? We are legislators. We want to know about the update, and we want to know when there will be a report given to us. I'm sure that it's not just Mr. Tick that is concerned about this item. Now the COVID epidemic is behind us. We will all want to know whether there will be new support services for elderly services or whether there is any cash schemes in place. Apart from Mr. Tick's suggestion asking for an item to be added to the agenda, any other suggestions? Well, I'd say that there will be two items for discussion in the June regular meeting. I think regarding support for carers, there are lots of members who would like to speak. Let's see if we can have a discussion of the item proposed by Mr. Tick in either June or July. Before we move on to the agenda proper, I'd like to report to you that in the second half of April, the chief executive led a delegation to a visit in the Greater Bay Area. This is a new approach. Government officials undertake visits with legislators, and this would enhance understanding, and this is an opportunity for the two parties to have an exchange. I took the chance to have an exchange with the Secretary for Labour and Welfare, Mr. Sun, and I also learned that there are some ideas about social welfare. So I'm discussing with Mr. Sun to see whether in the second half of August we will be able to conduct a visit of about 3 to 4 days in Guangdong province on elderly services or services to persons with disabilities, PWDs. It is a very good example, the approach on the mainland. I'm sure that the visit will help us. I will work out the details with the administration when we have more specific details. We will give the information to members. Dr. Tick. Certainly, I support the arrangement. I understand that the secretary took NGOs to the mainland for a visit to see whether there is any room for NGOs to provide services for Hong Kong people on the mainland. It's not just NGOs that can play a role. There are some private operators who have expressed an interest. So whether it's a subvented homes, private homes, or projects on the mainland, And they will, these initiatives will provide more choices for Hong Kong people. I understand that there needs to be support services, say for example the residential care vouchers. Can they be used on the mainland? I do think that on top of a visit, perhaps we can talk to the administration to see if we can reach any breakthrough agreement to help Hong Kong people. To conclude, well, when it comes to the provision of welfare services, whether they are from non-profit making organizations or private, whether there is any room for development. The other area is whether individuals living in GBA or Guangdong province can receive welfare services provided by local organizations. Of course, there needs to be policies in place, and we would like to have some exchanges in this regard. I think that is the framework. As soon as we have information on paper, we will talk to members. We hope that our invitation to the Secretary for a visit in August will take off. Now, item on the agenda proper in the agenda, subsidizing training programs for professionals providing healthcare services in residential care homes. Let's invite the administration to join us. We have ample time. We have with us Principal Assistant Secretary for Labour and Welfare, Ms. Linda Law, Deputy Director of Social Welfare Department, Mr. Alex Wong, and two Assistant Directors of the Social Welfare Department, Mr. Tan Teck Yee and Ms. Hannah Yip. We'll have ample time for discussion on this item today. First, I will ask the administration to take us through the paper. You'll have 5 minutes. Members, if you would like to ask questions, please press the request to speak button. Good morning. I will make an opening remark first. Well, we have an aging population. So residential care service for PWDs and elderly people, The demand is increasing. Apart from providing hardware, we also concern about manpower requirement of these services. We also work on enhancing training and increasing supply to attract youngsters to join the profession in services. We have, in addition, subsidized 1,700 youngsters to enroll in enroll nurse general training programs to alleviate the manpower shortage of nurses in the sector, and this is also to meet future demand. Graduates of these programs will have to serve in non-governmental organizations or private organizations for no less than 3 years as enrolled nurses. For 23 and 24, there are about 427 subsidized places, compared to the 200 places where there is an increase of more than 100%. Well, the SWD has launched the enrolled nurse training program for the welfare sector. It has been very well received. For the three academic years, starting from 2017, of the 500 or so graduates, about 90%, that is 400 or so of them, have been working as enrolled nurses in general practice in welfare sectors. About 319 of them works in elderly homes. And 47 or so people worked in care homes for people with disabilities. We have conducted a survey on 186 graduates, that is the first cohort. Of the 139 graduates, 116 of them work in the welfare sector as EN In the general discipline, 93 of them works in residential care homes for the elderly and 11 works in homes for people with disabilities. We've also allocated additional resources that from 23-24 for the subsequent 5 years, we have training sponsorship schemes for occupational therapists and physiotherapists. There are about 570 students taking the courses in Tonghua College and other training institutes. For students in the master's degree or the bachelor's degree, they will have to undertake to work for at least 3 years or 2 years upon graduation. As at December 2020, there are 270 graduates that have received subsidy in these programs to work in the welfare sector. There are 137 occupational therapists and 133 physiotherapist graduates. That's my presentation. I'll be happy to hear comments from members. We have a list: Dr. Tik Chi Yun, Mr. Stanley Ng, Mr. Chen Pui Leung, Ms. Lam So Wai, Mr. Michael Lok, and Dr. David Lam. Dr. Tik Chi Yun, 5 minutes for each members. Regarding planning of manpower, I think the government is a step late, because manpower shortage is a long-standing problem in the welfare sector, and we've been making a number of suggestions. We support youngsters to take courses with these subsidized places. When they graduate, they work in the welfare sector. According to the PAS, about 80 or 90% of the graduates have been working in the welfare sector within that contract period. I'm concerned that after the contract period, they will just go somewhere. If I were someone working in the welfare sector, if I don't have a good pay, a pay that is less than those offered by the hospital authority, I would want to go, because there are very few training opportunities. It's different from working in a hospital. There aren't many chances for you to use your skills. So because of a career progression, remuneration, and a chance to use their skills, they are not inclined to stay. But of course, as some other people stay in the sector because they want to take care of PWDs or elderly people. I do think that these programs will not be very successful. We have 1,700 people under the program. Maybe 20-30% will stay in the welfare sector. But what about the places left by people who have left? This is not sustainable. Perhaps in the next agenda item, we will have an in-depth discussion about the problems faced by care homes and daycare homes. We offer subsidized places for youngsters to receive training, and then you tie them down for a few years. I don't think that is an effective approach, but it's better than nothing. So I support this. But in the long run, I do think we need to find solutions to address the long-term problem of manpower planning and training, so that we can have a steady supply of staff members in the sector.
The administration, please. Thank you for your question. We're not just starting the training program now in terms of occupational therapists and physiotherapists. Since 2012, we have started a similar program. For enrolled nurse, our first program started 2017-18. According to our survey, during the undertaking period, most of the students realized their promise. As mentioned in my presentation, as to whether or not they will stay in this sector, in general, for enrolled nurse and registered nurse, there are about 4,700 of them in the sector. Of course, we want to facilitate the nurses' work in the sector, and we want them to realize what they learned in the field to benefit the welfare sector. Recently, in collaboration with the Nursing Council of Hong Kong, we want to have nurses have internships in the social welfare sector. So they will spend 30% of their internship time in the welfare sector. Chair, in terms of internship, of course, it benefits the young persons, but it does not help with the attraction of talents. We have to face the reality that there are a lot of opportunities in the private sector. Just tying them down may not be the most effective way to retain talents. Regarding the undertaking period, if the period is over, how many of them will stay in the sector? There is another program that is the navigation scheme for young persons in care services. How many of them, after the scheme, stay in the welfare sector? Do you have such figures? This is one of the examples. Do you have such figures at hand on the navigation scheme? Thank you, Chairman. Perhaps I offer some figures regarding the navigation scheme. In 2010, late April, there are 606 students who graduated. About 80% of them stayed in the sector. Among them, 376 of them are working. They are working as care workers or health workers in the RCH. And there are a small portion of them who continued education and became an enrolled nurse. For students who have completed the navigation scheme and who stayed in the sector, so there are a number of them. Next, Mr. Stanley Ng, please. Chairman, I will have to declare interest. I provide professional training courses under the Employees Retaining Board in the FTU. Just now, the IPAS introduced the situation of Hong Kong. Just now, I think that there should be some kind of bridging in terms of the career path in the healthcare work sector. We need more healthcare workers. And when there is insufficient healthcare workers, we often think about imported workers. It seems that the administration has given up on training existing care workers. I think the government should provide retraining opportunities for existing staff. This will become a vicious circle by importing labor, and then the salary will be pushed down, and there are consequently less and less people joining the sector. There seems not to be a career progression path for the existing care workers or health workers in Hong Kong. We have put in a lot of resources in the sector, but it seems that we have failed to retain talents. And then after all these failures, the administration made claims that they will have to import labor to tackle the problem. I think that the administration should be genuine in helping the sector. We have a manpower study in the FTU. We proposed a comprehensive career ladder for health workers to become care workers and eventually an enrolled nurse. We proposed a comprehensive career ladder in our proposals. If the administration needs it, we can provide it to the administration. Thank you. The administration, please. In the next item, we will detail our proposal on the career progression path for health workers. On how care workers can help out in the welfare sectors and help the enrolled nurse. We have colleagues who are more familiar with the topic who will present it in the next item. Can you state your stance on this? We will conduct a review. So our stance is very clear. We are inviting consultants for tendering. In approximately mid-May, we will have such invitation of tender, and then we will conduct a review on the career progression path. Do you have a concrete timeline? Concrete work, we will have to discuss it in the next agenda item. Next, Mr. Chen Puileng, please. Thank you. I, in principle, support the subsidized training programs. So I would like to ask about paragraph 5 in the papers that this program has been very popular in 2023 to 2024. Five to six people are fighting for one subsidized place. In 2023 to 2024, almost 11 applicants are competing for a subsidized place. So I would like to ask this. Now, the number of subsidized places has been twofold. There are only three institutes that are providing training. If this course is so popular, should we consider increasing the number of institutes that can provide such kind of training such that more students who are interested can enroll in these courses? My second question. This paper sets out that in the three-year undertaking period, most of the graduates stay in the sector. Because there is such an undertaking period, of course, the students stay. Is there a survey on how many of them stay in the sector after the undertaking period? There are more and more people who join the sector. If there are a lot of people who leave the sector after the undertaking period, does it contradict the current situation for the keen competition of subsidized places? I think we should have these figures before we proceed to the next step. The administration, please. Thank you for your question. In terms of subsidized places, the institutes will have to take a look at their own manpower before they can open such courses. If the institutes can open a number of subsidized places, then we subvent most of the places. When they can accommodate more students to enroll in these courses, then we will subsidize more places. I thank Mr. Chen's first question about the undertaking period of 3 years. We conducted a survey of towards the 180 graduates who have completed or would complete the 2 year undertaking period. Among them, the responding rate was 75%. Among the 139 graduates who responded, there are approximately 90%, that is 116 graduates, meaning 83%, that are still working in the welfare sector as an enrolled nurse. Among the 116 of them, 93 of them works in the RCHD, and 10% of them work in RCHDs. Can you respond to the question on institutes? We have purchased all the places that we can. For institutes that are interested in opening such courses, we are in close liaison with them. When they can open such courses, we will make use of the resources to purchase all places available. So the bottleneck is at the number of places that can be offered by the institutes. So it's not that the government does not want to subsidize further. I would like to know about where the bottleneck is. I think for us, we can only look at the number of enrolled nurse courses, training places. As for how many places can be offered, I think it's the responsibility of another department. Well, we do have such market demand. And there is seems to be a mismatch between the number of training places and the market demand. When there are so many people who are interested in taking the courses, should we identify more institutes to provide such training places? I'm sure that a lot of organizations are interested. We have increased the number of subsidized training places, and we have also increased the number of institutes that participate. In 2017 to 18, we mainly worked with the Metropolitan University, and we purchased the places and subsidized the training places. In 2023, Tonghua College and Caritas Institute of Higher Education also participate in the scheme. So the number of places increased from 200 to 427. The increase is approximately 100%. If there are other institutes that can provide such training places, then we will see if we can subsidize more. Next, Ms. Lam Soo-Wai, please. Thank you. In terms of RCH manpower, I think we should have a comprehensive planning for EN training places. There are some ENs who told me about the fact that although there are a lot of people who stay in the sector after the undertaking period, there is little career progression path. I would like to ask the administration, on top of enrolled nurse courses, can we provide subsidized registered nurse courses such that for young people who want to progress in terms of career, they have an opportunity? For people who have applied for similar courses in the Metropolitan University, they may not be able to enroll, and most of the places are given to staff working under the hospital authority, but not those who work in the welfare sector. So in terms of a qualification framework and room for career progression path, do you have a comprehensive plan such that young people or young nurses can progress?
Let's hear from the administration. Yes, as the well, we will look at the manpower situation as well as the qualifications framework. Regarding registered nurses, we will have more discussion in relation to skills and qualification requirements, and that is in the next item. We will give you more information. Perhaps we will give you more details in the next item. But this is something to do with retention, to keep people in the welfare sector. And this is all down to whether you have the right plans in place or whether you have used resources in the right way. Well, you keep saying that there will be a discussion in the next item. And I heard it a number of times. I'm the chairperson. I don't really understand why you would do it this way. This agenda item focuses on something that happens more recently. But we are legislators. Say, paragraph 6. Well, 496 people worked in the welfare sector during the undertaking period out of 558 graduates. We're concerned about the number of people that continue to work in the welfare sector after they have completed the undertaking period, because resources have been spent on it. And just now Ms. Lam mentioned a very valid point. If people don't see a future in their career, in the profession, then they will leave. So this is very relevant. We need to have long-term plans and strategies to retain staff members in the welfare sector. And this can be done through the provision of career progression. In the long run, we'll give you more information in the next agenda item. Well, here we talk about vacancies. And in the coming 3 years, we will continue to increase places in RCHEs and RCHDs. As a result, we need to fill vacancies, and vacancies that are existing now and vacancies that will pop up in the future. We see vacancies in nurses, occupational therapists, and physiotherapists. We want to find a way to fill existing vacancies and future vacancies as soon as possible. We do agree that we need to address immediate planning needs and long-term planning needs. We will give you information under these two agenda items. Next, Mr. Michael Lok. Thank you. If you want to keep people in the welfare sector to continue to work, training them is one of the effective ways. I see that it is quite well received. We have 4,000 people fighting for 400 places, so 10 people competing for one place. People who are already working as health workers in the sector, the young ones especially, they would like to progress. They would want to become enrolled. They would want to become enrolled nurses. They might just have a full certificate or just 2 points in the DSE. they have minimum qualification, but if they have experience, can they be given merit under the training program for subsidized places? Or will you set aside a certain number of places, say 20% of the subsidized places are for people who are already in the profession so that they can move up? Mr. Wong, well, as to whether we will give people who are already working as health workers a special consideration in enrolling of the programs, well, the institutions may take that into account in their application. But we will see whether we will explicitly state it as one of the consideration in student intake. For progression from care workers to health workers to enrolled nurses, we have seen these cases in the welfare sector. This brings us to the next agenda item about the qualifications framework. Can I say something? Do you have any figures to give us? Well, for enrolled nurse students, how many of them had experience as health workers? Or is it the case that they will be considered in the interview? Do you know that it's actually being considered? Or can you give us figures? What is the percentage? I'll defer to Mr. Tan. Let me use the navigation scheme as an example, because the scheme targets young people, and they've been working as care workers and health workers. Well, as at the end of December 2021, for students under the navigation scheme, well, some of them continue with their studies. There are about 210 of them that continue with their studies, and about 95 of them, that is half of them, enrolled nurse programs, some under the Metropolitan University, under the SWD subsidized schemes, and there are also people who went to the Tong Wah College and the Caritas Institute, and these are not subsidized places. And there are some ancillary places of enrolled nurses under the Hospital Authority, only 9 places. When we work out agreements with these institutes, we expect the institutes to accord priorities to graduates under the navigation scheme, but there is a condition. The candidates will have to meet the entry requirements of these institutes. Well, if the entry criteria is too lax for graduates from navigation schemes, then there is a chance that they may not be able to make it all the way to graduation if they don't meet the requirements. What about health workers not from the navigation scheme? I hope that these institutes would encourage them to enroll in these courses. Give them special considerations because, well, a guaranteed entry into the sector is very important on top of progression as well. And if they get a chance to enroll in these courses, it will be of great help to them. Dr. David Lam, thank you. A few weeks ago, I attended an occasion. It involved social workers, health workers, enrolled nurses. They've been working in the profession for decades. I see that they have passion. But as a number of members have said, that for youngsters, they don't really have a career progression, and it seems that wastage is quite high. Number of enrollment for enrolled nurses is about 50 people competing for one place. And it seems that your program is quite successful. However, have you considered that it takes time to train a nurse? Well, you started buying these places a few years ago. I've recently visited Tonghua College. There are some enrolled nurse students in the first or second years. Have you spoken to them? If they want to work in the welfare sector, perhaps you can pay them the tuition fees for the first and the second years. They were not studying under the subsidized places, but could you cover them in your subsidized schemes so that they'll be included in your program, so that they will work in the sector? Regarding enrolled nurses or nurses in residential care homes, they play a very important role. They provide a comprehensive nursing care. They are in charge of infection control measures, guiding and supervising healthcare workers and care workers, as well as handling administrative duties. These are important duties. What can a graduate enrolled nurse student take up these duties? I have a suggestion. Well, for large scale care homes, they have a very good structure. But what about smaller ones? Will you talk to the commissioner? Can there be uniform training and deployment for nurses in the in the sector? And if there is a need for smaller care homes for nurses, then they can be deployed from somewhere else. This will provide a better career path for nurses, and they will have better training. And this is also an opportunity for them to work in RCHGs or RCHDs. Mr. Wong, I thank Dr. Lam for his suggestions. I do agree that enrolled nurses working in social welfare sectors, they have to take up a number of different duties apart from special nursing care procedures. They are also in charge of guidance, supervision, and providing training. For placements in nursing programs, we want to cover places in welfare sectors. Currently, the percentage is under 30. We hope that for enrolled nurse students in their training, in their studies, if they have already come across working in the welfare sector, then it will be more conducive for them to understand better the roles and the skills required in working in the welfare sector. It's not just about hands-on work. It also involves roles in administrative duties and supervisory duties. For those who stay in the welfare, they have a satisfaction from the work they do. That's why they stay. Just now, Dr. Lam talked about training from different perspectives. We may consider that. Regarding the point about students in their first year in Tonghua College, we have heard you. We will go back to think about it to see if we can do it.
Can you supplement further? I've discussed with some experienced nurses. There is high requirements for capability to work as a nurse. It's not something that can be carried out by fresh graduates of enrolled nurse. If they have more experience in working as a health or care workers, it would be better. Can you see if there can be a consolidated kind of training for nurses in the community? Any response? I thank Dr. Lam for his question and suggestion. I will follow up on that. Ms. Judy Chan, please. Thank you. We all know about this navigation scheme for young persons in care services. There are people who say that it's not that attractive. Sometimes graduates do not stay in the sector after graduation. I see that the government has done a lot to retain talents, and I see that you do have such higher than trained scheme to help middle-aged women who are qualified. There are a lot of potential women labor that are waiting to be unleashed to the market. Can we have similar programs like the Women Empowerment Fund to unleash potential women labor? Can we have some more targeted kind of programs? For example, navigation schemes for women in care services, but not just a navigation scheme for young persons in care services, to tell women that although they, because of family commitment, cannot work in the sector because of, although they are qualified, I have a lot of friends whose kids are in primary schools and they want to re-enter the labor force. Can we have some more targeted schemes or programs for this group of people? This is an excellent suggestion. The administration, please. Thank you. It involves two schemes. First, the navigation scheme, when it was implemented in 2021, we made adjustments to the actual situation. We extended the age limit from 25 to 29. We will see if there is room for further adjustments. We have also adjusted the working time. It used to be just 44 hours a week. We have taken into account the situations of students and we adjusted the number of hours to 40 hours. So in terms of payment, we also put in place some reward. We are constantly reviewing the scheme that is ongoing. It is a scheme of 5 years. There is still time before it ends. Second, on the higher than trained scheme, it was commissioned by the Employees Retraining Board. The purpose is quite different. It is to retrain potential labor force, for example, women. The purpose is to train them to become a health worker. Is different from the navigation scheme. For people under the navigation scheme, they will become a health worker after completing the course. So it's for people who are interested and capable to join the sector. And as I've mentioned, some of them became enrolled nurse. I thank Ms. Chen for her suggestion. We will see how we can meet the needs of the market. Chairman, can I supplement? The response is clear. The navigation scheme is for people up to 29 years old. For the higher than trained scheme, there is not a targeted group of people. So it's not like the Women's Empowerment Fund. Whenever, as soon as people hear about the name, they will know that it's about women. is not specific enough. For this ceiling of 29 years old, I think we can further extend it, especially when we look at the labor structure in Hong Kong. There are a lot of people who are single in their 30s. I think that 29-year-old ceiling is not too realistic. Ms. Chen has a great suggestion. Is there any other member who would like to speak for a second round? If not, then I am the last one who will speak. As chairman of this panel, I see that the government is subsidizing three institutes to tie people down and encourage them to work in the sector during the undertaking period. I think that the papers are not good enough. We do not have information on how much we will spend or have spent on these programs. Second, for people who, well, for the legislation that are under discussion, for residential care homes legislation and RCHD legislation. Under this legislation, there will be additional manpower required. That are 470 of them. Do you have any plans such that we can fill these places up after the legislation amendment? Second, do you have any analysis? Well, there are about 4,500 nurses working in Hong Kong. Do you have a breakdown on how many of them are enrolled nurses or registered nurses? Is there any ratio of the number of nurses in private and public sectors? Do you have any analysis based on the figures that we have? Chairman, perhaps I'll respond to the issue regarding resources. In the coming 5 years, the government will subsidize an addition of 1,700 students. That involves $587 million. I defer to my colleague to respond to the other question. Thank you, Chairman. Regarding subsidy on physiotherapist and occupational therapy students, the government has earmarked 447 million subsidizing 750 students who are taking courses to become physiotherapist and occupational therapist. What about my other questions? On your second question about the additional manpower that is required upon legislation amendment, the amendment is underway. If it's passed next month, the in the fourth year of the material date, and in the fourth anniversary, there will be an additional 100 plus manpower needed. So we hope that since 2023 to 24, in 5 years' time, we will inject additional manpower to address the future need. We will review that constantly towards the end of the program, that is about 2027 to 28. We will then review if we should carry on with the program and see how many additional places that will be needed to meet the needs under the amended legislation. As member has suggested, we will see if we can open more places for PTOT in the future. And we'll see if we will be extending the scale of the program to fulfill the needs in the market. Are you confident that after the amendment, these programs will be able to fill the gaps? We are confident that we will be able to execute that, and we will be in close liaison with the institutes. such that after the legislation amendment, the additional manpower will be not met. Do you have analysis regarding the 4,000 plus nurses? I do not have such figures at hand. I thank you for a suggestion. We will look at the figures regarding how long the nurses stay in the sector and how many of them are in NGOs or subsidized institutes. I understand that you do not have all the figures at hand. As a chairman, I would like to say this. There are only a few pages on these two agenda items that we have today. There is little information in these papers, and the papers are very similar. I mean, for the two agenda items, there are so little information. The government may need to propose more items for discussion. The reason why the administration keeps deferring the response to the next agenda item is because we have two very similar agenda items. To spend $1 billion in a few years, I think we as Legislative Council members have the responsibility to question the long-term effectiveness. However, you do not have such or a very concrete response. I think that we should look at the matter holistically. How should we set the KPI? I hope that the administration, after attending this meeting, can have more concrete information for us. Because we're spending $1 billion on this scheme, and you tell me that you are only tying them down for 2 to 3 years, this is not what we're asking for. For us to spend 2 hours on these two agenda items, well, looking at the information, I think that this should be a single item. I will take a more cautious approach. Next agenda item, please. Next agenda item is review of skill and qualification requirements of residential care home staff. There are other government officials who will attend the meeting.
We have with us for this item Ms. Polly Kwok, Deputy Secretary for Labour and Welfare, Ms. Wong Yin-Yi, Deputy Director of Social Welfare Department, Ms. Nancy Kwan, Assistant Director of the Department, and Mr. Dave Yao, Chief Social Work Officer, also from the Social Welfare Department. Mr. Yao's in charge of licensing and regulation. You have a few minutes to take us through the paper. Members, if you'd like to ask questions, please press the request to speak button. Thank you, Chairman. I'll quickly go over the paper. This is a review of skill and qualification requirements of residential care home staff. In order to set qualification standards and career progression, we want to retain staff members and to attract more people to join the trade. In the 2022 policy address, the government announced that there will be a holistic review on the skill and qualification requirements of residential care home staff that provides care services. Majority of residents in care homes receive care and health services. Usually they are provided by professionals with professionals engaged by these homes or their allied health professionals who have received training. One of the areas under our review is to look into whether health workers who have received proper training can be given a promotion to take up more advanced care and health services. If we are to add a new rank, say for example, a senior health worker above health workers, what are the qualifications and training required? What will be the framework like? And this will be under our review. We are at the stage where we have issued the tender to interested parties. We hope that in the second half of this year, our work can start. We hope to complete the review by the end of next year. That's all for my opening remarks. We're looking forward to views and comments and questions from members. Sorry, I would like to ask you something. Did the four of you listen to our discussion in the last item? Yes, most of the time, but we missed a part when we're on our way here. Well, I have to tell you this on behalf of our members. Members expressed concerns about progression in the qualification framework and people who work in residential care homes, say for example, people who are enrolled nurses, can they get a chance to progress to become registered nurses? Well, apart from working as care workers, some people would like to progress and work as health workers. Just now, we were told by the administration that there would be a review. It is rather specific, according to you, that there is a need to establish a new rank of senior health worker on top of health workers is very specific. So I hope that you will answer our questions. If it's not directly related to a progression to senior health worker, but on something that is related. Well, I said that is one of the key areas in the review. This area is whether to establish a new rank of senior health workers and what additional information needs to be put in place. But there are other areas in the review. I haven't gone into them. If need be, I can give you more information. It's about manpower requirements and qualification frameworks. If you have any questions, we'll be happy to answer. Members, please press the request to speak button. We have Dr. Tik Chi Yun, Mr. Kingsley Wong, and Ms. Lam Soo Wai. 5 minutes, please. Dr. Tik. I fully agree with the chairperson's remark. The two items are about one thing. Staff, manpower needs of care homes, but these are broken into two different items and we have to say the same thing twice. Please make sure that it won't happen again. And it's difficult because our train of thoughts have been broken and I don't even know whether I should repeat myself to ask the same thing again. I welcome this comprehensive review of manpower requirements. It's a comprehensive review, not just about the establishment of an additional rank. A number of chief executives, the incumbent one or previous ones, talked about manpower shortage in this sector. This has been with us for over a decade. Youngsters don't want to join a trade. And we have a lot of workers who are already in their 50s or 60s. And even if they have retired, their contracts will be renewed because we have an aging population in healthcare workers. We have a manpower shortage, and people suggested that there should be imported labor. But there is no long-term solution. Regarding nurses, you may have schemes to try to lure them into the trade, give them tuition fees, try to tie them down for 3 years. But if there is no progression, no future, they will leave. So some people may have a passion to serve in the sector, but how many of them are there? We don't know. We're here to talk about recruitment difficulties. For care homes, we can't compete with the healthcare system. Say, for example, EN, RN, occupational therapist or physiotherapists. We offer a high pay to recruit, but it's not efficient. Some people say that you can't talk to them at with a loud voice because tomorrow they will just quit. If you don't address the difficulties, what you said, say attracting youngsters to enroll in EN programs, tie them down for 3 years, adding another rank will not solve the problem. That's why I said that we were talking about the whole package when regarding manpower requirements. You said that you have already issued a tender to engage a consultant. The review is to be completed by the end of next year. This is an imminent problem, but we're asked to wait. And there is also a working group on the care homes for children. We've already given you a suggestion a year ago, and it's still nothing concrete. What experts are they? Just now, the FTU has given a good suggestion to address the problem. I know that a lot of people from the sector have given you a lot of good and constructive input. And we talk about remuneration, career progression. You only need 3 months, but now you have started a tender to engage a consultant, so we'll only see the review complete next year. The sector is suffering a lot, and you ask us to put up with it for another year or two, and we don't even know whether there will be a result. The administration hasn't done much. They're just dragging their feet. Let's dispense with a consultant. Set up a working group headed by the director. Require the working group to complete a report in 9 months and implement the initiatives that are ready. Now you want to engage a consultant to conduct a study. This is just a delay. We've been talking about the same problems for many years. We don't need experts. We don't need people with wisdom. We need action. DS. Yes, we heard members' concern and that they would like us to expedite our work. We need to engage a consultant because we're talking about care homes with a different subsidy mode and different care level. We would like our consultant to collect data on site to see their respective staff requirements to provide rehabilitation services, care services. We need to set a baseline. The exercise itself is not minor to care homes. We want to enrich the career progression. This affects staff members of different ranks. We would like to collect views from stakeholders. That's why we need more time, Dr. Tick. Well, we've been talking about this for decades. You're not starting from scratch. I'm sure you fully understand what is going on. We're not starting this from scratch. This didn't start yesterday. We've been talking about this for decades. Why do you act as if we've just started it? Well, my time is up. Perhaps I'll give my time to other members. Mr. Kingsley Wong, thank you, Chair, for allowing me to attend this meeting. I'm quite concerned about providing good services to elderly people as well as providing a good environment for staff members. Well, I see that this covers two areas. First, manpower requirements and career progression. Regarding the former, you need to take a more macro perspective. We see huge developments in elderly services on the mainland. The secretary has been to a visit. We see good level of service with fees of just $4,000. So can you give us more information? Say, for example, before and after policy intervention. If Hong Kong people retire on the mainland and receive elderly services, will that have an implication on manpower? Regarding progression, career progression. Well, you talk about health workers, but what about care workers? You expect care workers to be a care worker their whole life? What about promotion prospect? Say, if they work for 4 years, can they be promoted to senior care workers? And what about becoming a health worker from a care worker, apart from training? What about experience? Well, we talk about examinations before you get a promotion. There are people who've been working as care workers for many years. Can their experience be counted in the promotion to health workers? Yes, thank you. About different options of providing elderly care services in the GBA. We're looking into the various options. In the second half of this year, we will launch a program. There are two care homes in the GBA. We are considering how to expand the services to care homes of a good quality so that Hong Kong people can retire in GBA with better choices. I talk about a career ladder. Well, if senior health workers can take up more nursing duties, this will be conducive for the entire situation. That's why I highlight this aspect. I haven't talked about the other areas, but it doesn't mean that they're not important. We want to conduct this review to see the experience, training, and skills required for the different ranks. Because of historical issues, for each rank, they have their respective requirements. We want to conduct this review to see if these requirements or training are still updated, and whether there is any need for changes, and whether there will be better career progression or bridging between these ranks. We look at the different ranks of health workers. We will also cover supervisors as well.
Ms. Lam Soo Wai, thank you, Chairman. I agree with you that both agenda items today have to do with the long-term planning of RCH staff. In the last agenda item, I've also mentioned this regarding enrolled nurses. They do have some training programs for them, but how to retain the young people in the social welfare sector such that they stay behind after the 3-year undertaking period? One of the important incentive is the good career progression path. Sometimes after they become enrolled nurse, then they stay in the same rank. Do the administration has any a plan such that, well, after a health worker has been promoted to an enrolled nurse, such that they can become a registered nurse, such that they do see a long-term career progression path or upward mobility? My second point, on the rank of senior health worker, I do support this proposal because for frontline workers, sometimes a senior health worker can take up the work. It does not have to do. It does not have to be done by an enrolled nurse. But do you have a detailed arrangement for promotion such that is it that a health worker can be promoted after they have worked in the sector for a number of years, or do they have to take some examinations? For career change of women and men in the community, can they change to become a health worker after working in the sector for a number of years? There is manpower shortage in the RCH sector. Apart from nurturing talents in Hong Kong, I do support the idea of importing labor from other places. For importing labor in the healthcare sector, who will be executing this special scheme for importation of labor? What will the qualification framework be like for this group of trained workers? Thank you for your question. Regarding your question on enrolled nurse, whether they can be promoted to a registered nurse, there are certain requirements for a person to be promoted to registered nurse. So the professional requirements is set out by the Nursing Council of Hong Kong. A person can only become RN after they have fulfilled the requirements. Some enrolled nurse in the social welfare sector told us that there are some high-level jobs in the sector. For example, some administrative works in the RCH, they can become, for example, a home manager. And they will be supervising staff. And from this kind of work, they can obtain a certain level of job satisfaction. For nurses that are working in residential care homes, if they want to be promoted further, they can take some supervisory courses. There are a lot of home managers of RCH that are enrolled nurses. Apart from this, regarding the health worker issue, we hope that for existing or incumbent health workers or the potential health workers, regarding the registration requirements and the requirements on number of years of experience, I hope that we can receive some suggestions under this review. We hope that with the review, we have some proposals on this. Just now, the Deputy Secretary mentioned about the training for home manager. There is such kind of training in the residential care homes. I've received some comments from users. For private homes manager training, there is such kind of courses in the private sector, but there is none in the public sector. So there is some kind of discrepancy between the performance of home managers in public and private sectors. Do you have some monitoring mechanism regarding the performance of the home managers? Thank you for your question. Regarding job training in the residential care homes for elderly and persons with disabilities, we do have some requirements in the code of practice. I would like to invite the Social Welfare Department to elaborate on that. Thank you. the home manager of a residential care home is the most important person. In the past few years, we attach great importance in the professionalization of the home manager. So we do have some subsidizing scheme on the training of care worker, health worker, and home managers. So for home managers of public and private sectors, we encourage them to participate in the home manager training scheme. And we will have a legislation amendment in the future such that home managers will have to be licensed and they will have to take courses before they are qualified. Thank you. Next, Mr. Stanley Lee. Thank you. For the review of skill and qualifications of RCH staff, I do think that there is such a need. Now, the government is engaging a consultant to review. I do not quite understand such move. Shouldn't the government departments be reaching out to the sector to conduct a review? There's been a past review conducted by the Polytechnic University, and the result of that review is just repetitive of what we've said. I wonder how much money the government is spending on engaging such consultant, and do the consultants have relevant experience? And the consultant may just be engaging or conducting survey with the existing RCH. I have made a proposal on establishing a qualification framework like the one in Japan, such that they can progress, the healthcare workers can progress level by level. My next question is this. The home manager of RCH will have to be licensed, and there will be some training for them. Can the government help the workers in the sector, different workers in the sector, to enhance their skills? Thank you. Regarding training, perhaps I'd invite the social welfare department to supplement. As for why we need a consultant to help us conduct such review, apart from collecting views from different stakeholders, we want to have a more scientific kind of approach to conduct review on residential care homes of different funding modes and of various care levels, because they do have different manpower need and there are different requirements on them and service agreements. So there is different needs of different RCHE and RCHD. So they will have to conduct field works and different types of RCH. For RCH providing different level of cares, do they all have to have one health worker that is on duty 24 hours a day? So we do need some kind of scientific data for us to review the manpower need. That is why we engage the consultant. Perhaps I elaborate on this sponsorship scheme on RCH staff. It was implemented in 2019. As mentioned, there is a home manager training program, and we also have other training programs for care staff and health worker. We have established qualification frameworks. For example, home manager is accredited at level 4, health workers level 3, and care workers level 2. So in collaboration with this sector, we hope that the workers will be able to acquire more knowledge and enhance their skills as a result, apart from the So for the programs that has been mentioned, we will subsidize them in full. For each and every staff that are undergoing courses, we will subsidize the RCH to employ extra staff to take up the work of these workers that are taking courses. So for home managers, health workers, and care staff, we subsidize them to take courses in full. And we encourage the sector to make use of our subsidy schemes. Because of COVID in the past few years, sometimes the health workers and care staff may not be able to take courses because they are so busy. So we encourage the workers in the sector to take courses as soon as possible. Dr. Lam, please. Thank you, Chairman. I am a doctor. In this sector, in a community setting, a nurse plays a very important role. It's not something that can be done by a fresh graduate of nurse because they have to supervise staff and they have to make decisions on how the patient is to be handled if there is emergency, on top of other administrative duties. Should we adopt the same career path of, for example, care worker promoting to health worker and enrolled nurse? Should we review holistically on the development of primary health care? Should we have a consolidated kind of training for nurses in the entire sector? Should we liaise with Health Bureau to see how that can be realized? Such that the RCH does not have to hire nurses by themselves and we have a community nurses that can work across the sector. I hope that you can talk about that with the Health Bureau as your next step. Thank you. We are in close liaison with the Health Bureau regarding training of nurses. As mentioned by my colleague in the last agenda item, we are in close communication with the Health Bureau. The Nursing Council of Hong Kong has increased the number of hours of placement in the community for nurses. So we have increased the number of hours of placement for enrolled nurses working in the social and welfare sector such that they can understand whether or not they want to stay in the sector upon graduation, and we will continue to liaise with the Health Bureau regarding this issue.
I would like to say to members, if you haven't asked questions or if you would like to have a second round, you may do so. Now it's my turn. DS, I'm sure you have heard, members, there is an imminent need from the sector. I think the review will take more than a year and a half. This is a rather long time for a consultant's review. We don't even know when that will become effective. And the labor sector has said that when it comes to importation of labor, it's effective immediately, but whereas other issues, there's always time needed. The Secretary for Labor talked about a special scheme to import care workers. He was lobbying members and he said that this should be done in an expedient way. And he said that local care workers could be promoted to health workers with the importation of care workers? Well, you want to import labor as soon as possible. However, regarding promotion of care workers to health workers, it's taken too long. It's not the case that we don't support that. We want more macro initiatives, but these initiatives are delayed and are full of uncertainties. And I heard about a review on different funding modes. Well, I understand that there is a contract, there is direct subvention, board places. So I think you are referring to these different modes in funding mode. Our doubt on block allocation is about staff members. With a block allocation, then the practitioners have lost a stable career progression. Well, if we're talking about a huge manpower demand and onerous duties, are you on the same page as us? Well, since there is a retention problem, perhaps you should scrap the block allocation. Just use a more stable structure, putting in place clearly the remuneration package, scale of pay, qualification framework, and corresponding pay, instead of having a framework where everything is unclear. I want to see what direction you will take. If you will consider that path, we will give you the patience you ask of us for this review. In relation to the special scheme to import labor in care homes, it was announced in the policy address last year, and it will only be launched in June this year. It takes some time because we've conducted consultation, say with the Labour Advisory Board, we've been to the Elderly Commission, we've been to the Welfare Service Panel. We need time to collect views, so it cannot be done overnight. The review will take time, I've already explained. We're talking about an overhaul of the career ladder and promotion prospects of the entire sector. We're talking about major changes in our policy. That's why we need to have a review that is more in-depth, more extensive. We need to collect data about funding modes of care homes. Well, we don't have any more subvented homes. Well, we still have about 100 or so. We just let them stay. But for new ones, subvention is no longer an option. For government projects, it will be done by contract. By that, I mean whether the operator is an NGO or a private operator, they can put in a bid to provide services. For board places, we want to leverage on the capacity of the private sector. If the home is a board place home, they get a steady income and they can make use of it to provide more space for each residence and better staff ratio. And we will work along these directions. Dr. Teck Chee Yuen speaking for the second time. Well, just now you said that well, you want to ensure more reasonable remuneration and possibly aligned with that of the Social Welfare Department. Of course, the sector will welcome that. And if that can be done, then you will give them patience. But I'm afraid you don't need to give them that patience because this won't be done. And we'll need to address this in using different ways. I have some suggestions. Well, this topic is to review skill and qualification requirements of care home staff. The reply from the administration is that the review will be more extensive, say different skills and the different funding modes, and they may even touch on remuneration package. Say for senior health workers, you need to put in place their pay scale. We're talking about resources. You need to make sure that the target of the review is precise. Otherwise, it will deviate from what you said you would do. Perhaps you'll consider a more extensive scope of review. Well, I don't want to see that you do your own work after we have expressed our views. Perhaps you can go back and think of ways to try to compress the time required by about 6 months. Can you give us an interim report in 6 months or so? Please don't ignore our views. When you have the result of the tender, I'm sure that there is a terms of reference. Can you give us the terms of reference in writing? I want to know whether the scope of the review is what we have in mind, and we want to know whether under the review, the remuneration package will be included as well. I don't know whether you can change it, but at least you give us the information you have so that we will know the scope of the review. Yes. Well, the information is in the public domain, so we can give the information to members. We will give you the link after the meeting. In paragraph 4, you'll find information about the manpower projection on different areas. We hope that the consultant will give us recommendations on manpower projection. The information will help us in our future planning of subsidized services. Any questions from members? I would like to say that if we are to conduct a review, then you need to look at the original retention, that is to retain staff and to attract people to join the trade. We want to make sure that those who are in need of care will receive good quality of service. I think that should be the key area of the review. Members have given you very good ideas. The scope may not be specified in the tender, but I hope that you will make it very clear to the prospective consultant. Perhaps you can ask them to come to talk to us to solicit our views. We've come across a lot of new arrivals from the mainland. They work as nurses or relevant positions in hospitals, but they can't find similar work here is a waste. Perhaps you can look into a mutual recognition of mainland qualifications or people with care experience from overseas as well. How can we make good use of people like these? If there are no members who would like to ask questions, that's the end of our agenda item. Any other business? If not, let me say this again. I'm myself and Mr. Soon, the secretary, has had an exchange about a visit to the Greater Bay Area in summer to look at areas related to welfare. There was a suggestion from members for welfare operators, whether they are private ones or NGOs, can they develop their businesses in GBA? And Hong Kong people, can they receive welfare services in the GBA? And if so, what will be the financial arrangements or supporting arrangements? When we have more information, we will give them to we will give it to members through the Secretariat. If you have any work in mind that you would like to do in summer, please tell us. Thank you.